Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Women's Work, The First 20,000 Years, Women, Cloth, and Society in Early Times, by Elizabeth Wayland Barber, narrated by Donna Postel. Preface. My mother liked to weave and sew, so I grew up with interesting textiles all around, learning to sew and weave for myself at an early age. I was constantly being made aware of the form, color, and texture of cloth. Textiles have a particular crossing structure that dictates what sorts of patterns will be easy and obvious to weave, or conversely, hard to weave. Thus, later, when I began to study Classical and Bronze Age Mediterranean archaeology at college, I soon noticed decorations on durable things like pottery and walls that looked as if they had been copied from typical weaving patterns. But when I suggested this idea to archaeologists, they responded that nobody could have known how to weave such complicated textiles so early. The answer was hard to refute, on the face of it, because very few textiles have come down to us from before medieval times, outside of Egypt, where people generally wore plain white linen. Unconvinced, I decided to spend 2 weeks hunting for data on the degree of sophistication of the weaving technology, to see at least whether people could have made ornate textiles back then. I expected to write my findings into a small article, maybe 10 pages, suggesting that scholars ought to consider at least the possibility of early textile industries. But when I began to look, data for ancient textiles lay everywhere, waiting to be picked up. By the end of the 2 weeks, I realized that it would take me at least a summer or two to chase down and organize the leads I had turned up, and that I could be writing a 60-page monograph. By the end of 2 more summers, I knew I was headed for a 200-page book. That little book turned into a research project that consumed 17 years and yielded a 450-page tome covering many times the planned geographical area and time span. It finally appeared, in 1991, as Prehistoric Textiles from Princeton University Press. For that book, I had restricted myself to the history and development of the craft, a big enough topic, as it turned out. Along the way, I kept running across wonderful bits of information about the women, virtually always women, who produced these textiles, and about the values that different societies put on the products and their makers. When I talked about my work, people seemed especially eager for these vignettes, stories that told of women's lives thousands of years ago. They urged me to write a second book on the economic and social history of ancient textiles, in effect, on the women who made the cloth and clothing. Then, a friend asked me to read her unfinished translation of the memoirs of Nadezhda Durova, a woman who had spent 10 years disguised as a man serving in the Tsar's cavalry during the Napoleonic Wars. Far from giving a catalog of campaigns, battle arrays, and tactics, Durova spent the entire war recording how people lived from day to day, how she and her fellow soldiers interacted with horses, geese, each other, the weather, and the local folk with whom they were billeted. I am not normally fond of reading history, but this was different. I could hardly wait for each new installment, as I realized that the source of my fascination was the glimpses into real people's lives. I began to understand, in a new way, what my early material contained. This book has now appeared as The Cavalry Maiden, translated by Mary Fleming Zirin. Thus, I have tried to explore and pull together what real facts we can deduce about early women, their lives, their work, and their values, chiefly from the technological record of the one major product of women that has been well studied as yet, textiles. I have also paid some attention to what language can tell us. Messages perish as they are uttered, but language itself is remarkably durable. Sometimes it preserves useful clues to a more abstract and thought-oriented part of the human past than material artifacts do. Perhaps the most important thing that has been omitted from this book, however, is fiction. Romantics may enjoy Hollywood tales of Uga and Una grunting around the fire of a squat and hairy, stoop-shouldered Paleolithic ruffian after he has dragged them in by the hair from the next cave. Idealists may savor the rosy utopian visions of life before war, in a Neolithic age ruled by women totally connected to the pulse of Mother Earth. These stories are fun. But what, I ask, was life really like? What hard evidence do we have for what we might want to know about women's lives? No evidence means no real knowledge. Stacked against our endless questions, what we know remains small. And no matter how clever we become at tracking down evidence, if we want reality, we are stuck with what fragmentary facts we happen to have. I have not invented answers just to fill in, the way a screenwriter must. But we know much more than has gotten into the general literature about women's history. The reader will find glimpses of real women of all sorts: peasants, entrepreneurs, queens, slaves, honest souls and crooks, good and bad, high and low. For all the strangeness of their cultures, they seem refreshingly like us. Introduction. 4, 3, 2, 1. Good. One more bunch to go, then we've got to get dinner on. I yanked the loose knot out of the last bundle of pea-green warp threads and began passing the ends through the rows of tiny loops in the middle of the loom to my sister to tie up on the far side. The threads of the warp are those lying lengthwise in the finished cloth, and the most tedious part of making a new cloth comes in stringing these onto the loom, one at a time. Once you begin to weave in the cross threads, the weft, you can see the new cloth forming inch by inch under your fingers, and you feel a sense of accomplishment. But the warp just looks like thread, thread, and more thread. At this moment, I was balancing the pattern diagram on my knee, counting out which little loop each thread had to pass through on its way from my side of the loom to hers. For nearly 8 hours we had been working on the warp, between and around the interruptions. In the morning, we had wound off the requisite number of green and chocolate-brown threads of fine worsted wool, stripe by color stripe, onto the great frame of warping pegs, pegs that hold the threads in order while measuring them all to the same length. By lunchtime, we were ready to transfer the warp to the loom, tying one end of the long, thick bundle of yarn to the beam on one side. Then began the tedious task of threading the ends through the control loops, heddles, in the middle, on their way to the far beam. It would have been simpler if we had intended to use the plainest sort of weave. But because we were setting up to weave a pattern, the fine diagonal pattern called twill that is used typically today in men's suit material, it was taking far longer. Why am I doing this? I thought ruefully, glancing at the time. We've spent the entire day and aren't even ready to start weaving yet. If I spent this much time every day writing, my book would be finished in no time. One forgets that laying in the weft, the actual weaving, is only half the job of making a cloth, the second half. First comes the equally lengthy task of making, organizing, and mounting onto the loom the foundation set of threads, the warp. And that is where a helper really speeds the work. A friend to receive and fasten the other end of each long warp thread, saving all the time and energy of walking back and forth, from one end of the loom to the other. It is also much more entertaining to have a friend to chat with while the handwork proceeds. In fact, my sister and I were actors in a scene that, with only minor differences, has been repeated for millennia. Two women helping each other set up a weaving project. The looms, the fibers, the patterns may differ, but the relation of the women to their work, and to each other, is much the same. Unlike women of past ages, however, we were not making cloth for our households. when our mother entered a weaving school in Denmark 50 years ago. She was told to begin with a dozen plain dish towels, a useful way to gain skill on the loom, and start one's trousseau all at once. Nor were we weaving for sale, for piety, or for artistry, the other common reasons. We were weaving a thread-for-thread replica of a piece of plaid cloth lost in a salt mine in the Austrian Alps some 3,000 years ago. It was the salt that had preserved the handsome green and brown colors, as well as the cloth itself, and it was the color that caught my eye in the Natural History Museum in Vienna. That, and the particular objects surrounding the piece. The torn fragment of cloth, about the size of one's hand laid flat, nestled on a newly rewoven strip of identical cloth in such a way that the plaid stripes matched. Thus the visitor's eye could follow the pattern outward in both directions and comprehend what this ancient cloth must have looked like when it was new. And it looked, for all the world, like a simple plaid twill from some Scottish kilt. Furthermore, above and beside it were hung two furry leather caps, also from prehistoric shafts in the Hallstatt salt mines, of the exact same shape as a Scottish tam o'shanter or a beret from Brittany in western France, another outpost of Celtic culture. Between 1200 and 600 BC, the era when this cloth was apparently woven, the ancestors of the Celts were living in what is now Austria, Hungary, and southern Germany. Many of these people were miners, digging out of the mountains both metal ores and salt. Salt was very precious for preserving food before the days of refrigerators. Those who could supply it grew rich. By 400 BC, the early Celts were beginning to fan out westward across Europe, into France, Britain, and Spain, where they live today, carrying a culture directly descended from that of the Hallstatt miners. In a very real sense, I was looking at the original tam, and at the ancestor of the Scottish plaid tweed or twill, all produced by the immediate ancestors of the Celts. Twill, like tweed, comes from the word two, and refers to a distinctive method of pattern weaving in which the threads are paired. These habits of cloth and clothing that we associate today with Celts began in prehistoric times and traveled with them through space and time. I had been studying the scant remains of ancient cloth for almost a decade, and if one thing had become clear, it was that the traditions of cloth and clothing in most parts of the world were remarkably ancient. This display case eloquently said it all. "I'd love to have a scarf like that," I announced on the spot. So here I was, 2 months later, sitting at home trying to reproduce it from the diagrams in the scholarly publication. It had taken much hunting through weaver supply catalogs to find wool yarn of precisely the right colors and thickness, yarn that had also been combed and not carded. Combing the unspun fibers to lie parallel results in a strong, hard thread. Carding, on the other hand, makes the fiber lie all which way, just like teasing one's hair, and gives a soft, fluffy thread, like our knitting yarn. Most wool yarn now available is of this latter sort, but the process wasn't invented till the Middle Ages. If I was going to go to all this trouble, I wanted the replica to be as near exact as I could make it. Of course, if I had begun by raising and shearing a sheep, cleaning and dyeing the wool, then combing, spinning, and plying it, the long days spent warping would seem quite a small expenditure. After dinner, I began to weave, while my family sat nearby chatting. It took me half an hour to weave the wide swatch of plain green that preceded the first brown stripe. Having put all the intricacies of the twill patterning into the warp, by the way in which we had tied it onto the loom, the weaving was now straightforward, and it went fast. I reached the first color stripes and added a shuttle of brown thread. 4 brown rows, 4 green, 4 brown, 4 green. I was eager to see what the plaid would look like, and I cursed gently as first one shuttle, then the other, fell to the floor while I worked. The stripes were so narrow that it didn't seem worth tying off the finished color each time. So I put up with the nuisance. Another 4 brown, 4 green. Another shuttle hit the floor. Suddenly, light dawned on me. It had taken us so long to put the warp through the tiny control loops on the loom, because the pattern, simple as it looked, had actually been quite complicated. That was because both the color stripes and woven pattern stripes were so uneven in width. 16, 19, 20, 18. No 2 stripes that direction had exactly the same number of threads, and getting them all exactly correct had required great care. Now I was cursing at the stripes running crosswise, the weft stripes, because they were in little tiny sets of 4, an even number. I had done the replica backward. If my weft had been warp, its sets of 4 threads would correspond to what I knew to be the structure of the warp on the ancient loom, as well as to the twill pattern. Thus, the cloth would have been easy to warp up. Conversely, if my warp had been weft, the slight differences in the number of threads per stripe would make perfect sense. The weaver had not been counting, but judging by eye how far to weave before changing to the next stripe. Far from being unhappy at my mistake, I was delighted. Most fragments of prehistoric cloth from the Hallstatt salt mines, and there are more than 100 extant, are torn on all 4 edges, so it is not possible to tell which direction they were woven the way one usually does, simply by looking for the type of closed edges found only at the sides. But by trying to imitate the product, I discovered not only which way this shred was woven, and some criteria for analyzing other pieces, but also several interesting details about how Hallstatt weavers worked. The cloth ends up looking much the same either way, and the time had been doubly well spent. It was another lesson to me that the process of recreating ancient artifacts, step by step, can shed light on the lives and habits of the original craft workers that no amount of armchair theorizing can give. It is no longer possible to know most of the details of prehistoric women's lives. Far too much has been lost with the passage of time. Even in early historical times, in Egypt, Mesopotamia, Greece, very little of the ancient literary record was devoted to women, so we have few sources to consult. Indeed, the lack of clear sources has led to a good deal of guessing, even wishful thinking, in books about how women lived in early times, when the topic has not been omitted altogether. Here among the textiles, on the other hand, we can find some of the hard evidence we need, since textiles were one of women's primary concerns. We know, for example, that women sometimes helped each other with their weaving projects, exactly as in the modern scene, because we sometimes find the wefts in ancient cloth crossed in the middle of the textile. This can only have been caused by 2 people handing spools of weft back and forth to each other as they wove simultaneously on different parts of the same cloth. It is a tiny detail, but interesting precisely because of its realness. We also know, now, that prehistoric women sometimes wove their patterns by eye rather than strictly counting. Of course, being perishable, the textiles themselves are not easy to learn about. Just like most of the rest of women's products, such as food and the recipes for preparing it. Therefore, to recover the reality of women's history, we must develop excellent techniques. See Chapter 12. Using not just the obvious data, but learning to ferret out every helpful detail. Practical experiments, like reweaving some of the surviving ancient cloths, are a case in point. Among the thousands of archaeologists who have written about pottery or architecture, how many have actually tried to make a pot or build a building? Precious few. But with so much data available for study in these fields, scholars felt flooded with information already, and such radical steps hardly seemed necessary. Our case is different. We must use every discoverable clue. The available material is most revealing when treated chronologically, starting with the Stone Age and moving through the Bronze Age into the Iron Age. We can watch how the craft of cloth making develops and how women's roles change with the change of technology and its relation to society. But when I say chronologically, I mean in a conceptual way rather than strictly in terms of years. It could hardly be otherwise. At 3400 BC, as the Near East was edging into the Bronze Age, Central Europe remained at a Neolithic stage of economy, while the Arctic North was Mesolithic, and many other parts of the world still lay deep in the Paleolithic. To chart technological stages so heavily skewed from place to place against a scale of absolute time is difficult. Understanding the basis of the categorization is perhaps of greater help to a reader not acquainted with the system. When systematic archaeology began to emerge in the 19th century, long before modern methods of absolute dating were available, Danish scholars suggested dividing the pre-Roman artifacts into three successive groups based on the dominant material for tools: stone only, oldest, bronze in the middle, and iron, youngest. This system worked pretty well, but it soon became clear that the Stone Age was enormously long and needed a further division based on whether the stone tools were always chipped, Old Stone Age, or Paleolithic, or sometimes ground down to a smooth finish, New Stone Age, or Neolithic. As methods of recovering ancient remains became more refined, scholars noticed that polished stone tools correlated with the advent of agriculture. The grinding of tools was not unrelated to the grinding of grain. And gradually, as more and more material accrued, finer divisions were installed as needed. The simplest system was to divide into early, middle, and late, late into 1, 2, and 3, late 3 into A, B, and C, and so on. A pot might thus be assigned to early bronze 2A. But sometimes other terms fell to hand. Thus, the last levels of the Paleolithic era are those uppermost at Paleolithic sites, which themselves go back over a million years, and these uppermost layers correspond to a sudden blossoming of all sorts of arts and crafts in Europe after about 40,000 BC. The era thus represented came to be known as the Upper Paleolithic and was found to extend to at least 10,000 BC, later in some places. Its cutoff point is taken to be the advent of domestic plants and animals, which marked the beginning of the Neolithic. In Europe, the domesticated stocks were imported from the Near East in an ever-widening circle. Because the far northern climate was too harsh for easy agriculture, however, people there continued to live a Paleolithic lifestyle for millennia, augmented with a few handy Neolithic ideas borrowed from the South, such as actively herding the wild reindeer rather than just hunting them. This intermediate type of culture soon got nicknamed the Mesolithic. I have chosen to treat the Upper Paleolithic and Mesolithic together in Chapter 2, followed by the Neolithic, Chapter 3. The development of metalworking and of efficient metal tools marks the start of the Bronze Age, although again in the seminal areas there are transitional phases with various names: Copper Age, Chalcolithic, Aeolithic. In the Near East, the beginning of the Bronze Age, shortly before 3000 BC, is accompanied, or triggered, by radical changes in living conditions. Cities spring up everywhere, and writing is invented. Again, the innovations are not unrelated to each other. Bronze Age technology and urbanization quickly spread to southeastern Europe, but some aspects of life there continued with one foot in the Neolithic, an interesting hybridization that allowed textiles to flourish, Chapter 4. The mainstream of Bronze Age life developed full speed ahead in Mesopotamia, Chapter 7, and Egypt, Chapter 8, eventually reaching Greece in its full form in the Late Bronze Age, midway through the second millennium BC, Chapter 9. only to be cut off around 1200 BC by waves of destructive migrations emanating ultimately from the steppes of Central Asia. After the dust settles and the smoke clears away, we find the Mediterranean countries in possession of some new ways of living and of a new and much harder metal, iron, in an era suitably called the Iron Age, Chapter 11. It takes another 200 to 400 years, however, for the complex technology of ironworking to make its way all the way across Europe, during which time Bronze Age labels in some parts of Europe correspond, in absolute years, to Iron Age labels in other parts. By the mid-first millennium BC, when iron was reaching the far west, and when this book ends, Southern Europe and the Near East had already experienced vast cultural developments and redevelopments, whereas most other areas had not yet gotten on their feet, China, Northern India, and Central America excepted. The chapters that follow concentrate on this geographical area of early development, and for the most part omit the rest. Of course, the same methods developed here can be applied to those other times and places to recover more of their histories. 1. A tradition with a reason. For millennia, women have sat together, spinning, weaving, and sewing. Why should textiles have become their craft par excellence, rather than the work of men? Was it always thus? And if so, why? 20 years ago, Judith Brown wrote a little 5-page note on the division of labor by sex that holds a simple key to these questions. She was interested in how much women contributed to obtaining the food for a pre-industrial community. But in answering that question, she came upon a model of much wider applicability. She found that the issue of whether or not the community relies upon women as the chief providers of a given type of labor depends upon the compatibility of this pursuit with the demands of childcare. If only because of the exigencies of breastfeeding, which until recently was typically continued for 2 or 3 years per child, nowhere in the world is the rearing of children primarily the responsibility of men. Thus, if the productive labor of women is not to be lost to the society during the childbearing years, the jobs regularly assigned to women must be carefully chosen to be compatible with simultaneous child watching. From empirical observation, Brown gleans that such activities have the following characteristics. They do not require rapt concentration and are relatively dull and repetitive. They are easily interruptible. I see a rueful smile on every caregiver's face. And easily resumed once interrupted. They do not place the child in potential danger, and they do not require the participant to range very far from home. Just such are the crafts of spinning, weaving, and sewing. Repetitive, easy to pick up at any point, reasonably child-safe, and easily done at home. Contrast the idea of swinging a pick in a dark, cramped, and dusty mineshaft with a baby on one's back, or being interrupted by a child's crisis while trying to pour molten metal into a set of molds. The only other occupation that fits the criteria even half so well is that of preparing the daily food. Food and clothing, these are what societies worldwide have come to see as the core of women's work, although other tasks may be added to the load, depending upon the circumstances of the particular society. Readers of this book live in a different world. The Industrial Revolution has moved basic textile work out of the home and into large, inherently dangerous factories. We buy our clothing ready-made. It is a rare person in our cities who has ever spun thread or woven cloth, although a quick look into a fabric store will show that many women still sew. As a result, most of us are unaware of how time-consuming the task of making the cloth for a family used to be. In Denmark, 50 years ago, young women bought their yarns ready-made, but still expected to weave the basic cloth for their households. If they went to a weaving school, rather than being taught at home, they began with a dozen plain cotton dish towels. my mother, being a foreigner not in need of a trousseau, and with less than a year at her disposal to study Danish weaving, consented to weave half of one towel to get started. The next assignment was to weave 3 waffle-weaved bath mats. Indeed, the 3 were nicely gauged to last a lifetime. The second wore out when I was in college, and we still have the third. Next came the weaving of woolen scarves and blankets, linen tablecloths, and so forth. Most complicated were the elaborate aprons for Sunday best. 30 years ago in rural Greece, much had changed, but not all. People wore store-bought, factory-made clothing of cotton for daily wear, at least in summer. But traditional festive outfits and all the household woolens were still made from scratch. It takes several hours to spin with a hand spindle, the amount of yarn one can weave up in an hour. So women spun as they watched the children, girls spun as they watched the sheep, both spun as they trudged or rode muleback from one village to another on errands. The tools and materials were light and portable, and the double use of the time made both the spinning and the trudging, or watching, more interesting. In fact, if we reckon up the cleaning, spinning, dyeing, weaving, and embroidering of the wool, the villagers appeared to spend at least as many labor hours on making cloth as on producing the food to be eaten. And these people bought half their clothing ready-made. Records show that, before the invention of the steam engine and the great factory machines that it could run, this sort of distribution of time and labor was quite normal. Most of the hours of the woman's day, and occasionally of the man's, were spent on textile-related activities. In Europe, men typically helped tend and shear the sheep, plant and harvest the flax, and market any extra textiles available for cash income. So why is it, if women were so enslaved by textile work for all those centuries, that the spinning jenny and power loom were invented by a man and not a woman? A young woman accosted me with this question after a lecture recently. The reason, to quote George Foster, writing about problems in pottery making, lies in the nature of the productive process itself, which places a premium on strict adherence to tried and proven ways as a means of avoiding economic catastrophe. Put another way, women of all but the top social and economic classes were so busy just trying to get through what had to be done each day that they didn't have excess time or materials to experiment with new ways of doing things. My husband bought and learned to use a new word processing program 2 years before I began to use it, for exactly these reasons. I was in the middle of writing a book using the old system, and couldn't afford to take the time out both to learn the new one and to convert everything. I was already too deep into production. Elise Boulding elaborates, "The general situation of little margin for error leading to conservatism might apply to the whole range of activities carried out by women. Because they had so much to do, slight variations in care of farm or dairy products or pottery could lead to food spoilage, production failure, and a consequent increase in already heavy burdens. The rich women, on the other hand, didn't have the incentive to invent labor-saving machinery, since the work was done for them. And so for millennia, women devoted their lives to making the cloth and clothing while they tended the children and the cooking pot. Or at least that was the case in the broad zone of temperate climates, where cloth was spun and woven, rather than made of skins, as in the Arctic, and where the weather was too cold for part or all of the year to go without a warming wrap, as one could in the tropics. Consequently, it was in the temperate zone that the Industrial Revolution eventually began. The Industrial Revolution was a time of steam engines. Along with the locomotive to solve transportation problems, the first major applications of the new engines were mechanizations of the making of cloth. The power loom, the spinning jenny, the cotton gin. The consequences of yanking women and children out of the home to tend these huge, dangerous, and implacable machines in the mills caused the devastating social problems, which writers like Charles Dickens, Charlotte Bronte, and Elizabeth Gaskell, all of whom knew each other, portrayed so vividly. Such a factory is the antithesis of being compatible with child-rearing on every point in Judith Brown's list. Western industrial society has evolved so far that most of us don't recognize Dickens's picture now, although it still does exist in some parts of the world. We are looking forward into a new age, when women who so desire can rear their children quietly at home while they pursue a career on their child-safe, relatively interruptible and resumable home computers, linked to the world not by muleback or the steam locomotive, or even a car, but by the telephone and the modem. For their part, the handloom, the needle, and the other fiber crafts can still form satisfying hobbies, as they too remain compatible with child watching. Spinning and weaving were such common household activities for millennia that everyone undoubtedly knew how they worked, whether ever performing the actions or not. But now that factory machines have taken over these jobs, most Americans have engaged in weaving only as a childhood game, such as weaving little potholders out of the stretchy loops in a kit, and have never encountered spinning. A brief description of these basic processes is thus in order. Weaving cloth requires thread of some sort, and thread is made from fibers, so we must begin with the fibers. Imagine yourself with a handful of coarse fibers, or better yet, go get some. Not cotton. Cotton hairs are extremely short and fine, so you can't see how they behave. They are also not easy to spin for these reasons. Imagine instead a hank of wool, just as it comes off the back of a sheep or goat. You may have seen it stuck to the fence of a cage at the zoo. Or take the long, coarse fibers from a rotted plant stem, or from a piece of old frayed rope or twine. Rope used to be made chiefly from hemp, the species to which marijuana belongs, but now it is usually made from synthetics, which are slippery and therefore hard to work with. To make thread out of these fibers, you must twist them together long ways, a few at a time. Although each individual fiber is weak, twisting a number of them together can make a thread that is quite strong. An easy way to do this is to take a small bunch of fibers and roll one end down your thigh with the flat of your hand, while holding the other end tight. Thus, one end gets twisted with respect to the other end, locking the fibers together in the process. If the fibers you begin with are also very long, that may be all you have to do. Hemp, for instance, grows 12 feet high, so you can make a 12-foot string by doing nothing more than adding twist to the natural fibers. Flax, which gives the fine material we call linen when it is processed, grows to 4 feet, while silk fibers, which are unwound from the cocoon of a special species of moth, may be as much as 1,000 yards long and incredibly thin. But most fibers are not that long. Wool is, at best, only a few inches in length, and usually much shorter. Cotton is shorter still. So we need some way to make thread longer than any one single fiber, extending it as long as we please. To accomplish that, imagine overlapping the end of one bundle of fibers over the ends of the previous group before adding the twist that locks them together. But you can see that we will get lumpy spots at the overlap and thin spots in between. Some ancient thread is actually made that way. What we really need is a way to keep a constant trickle of overlapping fibers flowing into the thread as we make it, instead of adding them in discrete bunches. To do this, we need some preparation and a simple tool, the spindle. First, the fibers you draw from must be loose and not tangled together, so you can get the exact amount you need at all times. Otherwise, you will suddenly find you have pulled a big clot of them all at once. Or worse, gotten too few somewhere, so the thread gets too thin and breaks. There are two basic ways of arranging the fibers for spinning as you loosen them: laying them parallel to each other, or encouraging them to lie every which way in a fluffy mass. This is practical only with fairly short fibers. You can make them sit parallel by combing them, much the way you comb your hair to get the tangles out. Then you get a very strong thread, called worsted, that is also very hard to the touch because it has no fluffiness. The fibers all are packed in close, lying right next to one another as they twist. Men's wool suits today are usually made of worsted thread for long wear. If you want softness, however, you can use carding paddles to loosen the tangles in the fibers without actually combing them. These flat boards with handles have lots of little bent teeth to pull the fibers apart so they lie in all directions. The name comes from the Latin word for a thistle, carduus, because in ancient times the teeth of thistles were set into boards for fluffing fiber. The process of carding is much like teasing your hair to make it fluffy. The problem with yarn from carded fiber, however, is that it is rather weak and breaks easily. Modern knitting yarns are almost invariably carded, and they can afford to be, because the knitted loops make the cloth stretchy enough to offset the relative weakness of the yarn. Sweaters knitted from these carded yarns feel soft and even spongy. Once you have your fibers prepared, you are ready to spin. The crudest way, and probably the oldest, is the one we have mentioned. Taking a small bunch of fibers and rolling one end down your thigh with the flat of your hand while holding on to the other end. But to get a constant stream of fibers flowing into the thread as you make it, you need one hand to hold the prepared fibers, another to add them to the thread, a third to keep twisting, the core operation, and a fourth to hold the finished thread, because if you let go of the new yarn at this stage, it will instantly ball up in a snarl like an angry rubber band, and then start coming apart. Time for some tools. We don't have four hands. A spindle is basically just a stick, usually about a foot long. When the end of the new thread has been attached to the tip of the stick, turning the stick will force the end of the thread to turn, too, adding twist to the fibers to make the thread. But when some thread has been finished, it can be wound around the stick to keep it from tangling, while still more is being spun. Thus, the tool that twists is, at the same time, the tool that holds. That reduces the needed hands to three. How to get it down to two? One hand must always be used for the crucial job of adding the fibers at a controlled rate into the new thread. Well, somehow the spindle must be kept turning, and the fiber supply must be held near. One solution is to lay the fiber supply down on the ground, turn the spindle with one hand, and use the other to flick the fibers, a few at a time, into the growing thread. This is how ancient Mesopotamian women did it, as well as rural women today in the Sudan. It is practical if and only if the fibers are quite short, less than a couple of inches long. The other solution is to hold the fibers and drop the spindle after giving it a quick flick to start it spinning like a top. It hangs in the air like a yo-yo, whirling merrily on its thread, while the spinner uses one hand to hold the unspun fiber and the other to control the feeding of the fibers into the twist. When the new thread gets so long that the spindle reaches the ground, you have to stop and wind everything up on the spindle shaft and then start the spindle twirling again in the air. This is the way European peasants spin, and apparently always have. It has the advantage of being entirely portable, since nothing has to be laid down. In fact, I have seen Greek village women spinning quite handily while riding side saddle on muleback. In order to be able to carry a big supply of raw material, one can bind the prepared fiber to a long stick or board called a distaff, from an old word, dis, meaning fuzz, fiber, plus staff, a fuzz stick. Back in the Neolithic era, people discovered that to reduce wobble as the spindle turns and to prolong the spin, it is helpful to add a little flywheel, a small disc called a spindle whorl. Spindles are usually wooden. Whorls are most often of clay. But one can use an apple, a potato, or a rock for the whorl, if nothing else is available. Contrary to popular assumption, it doesn't have to be perfectly round, as long as the spindle shaft goes through the very middle of it. Spinning this way is slow, but far faster than rolling the thread on the thigh with no spindle. Early in the Middle Ages, however, a new invention appeared, the spinning wheel. Just who invented it is still unknown, although an old Chinese device for winding thread may have been the inspiration. The foot-powered spinning wheel allowed people to spin about 4 times faster than with the dropped spindle, so it was much in demand. But the principle is exactly the same as with a hand spindle. Pull fibers, twist them, and wind up the thread. Finally, in the late 18th century, early in the Industrial Revolution, a man named James Hargreaves invented a mechanical spinning machine, later nicknamed the spinning jenny, because he was distressed at how hard his wife and daughters had to work to spin their increasingly large quotas of thread for the new power looms. The women in his family were delighted, but his neighbors became fiercely jealous of the unfair competition and ran him out of town after wrecking his first machine. To keep the thread from untwisting when it is taken off the filled spindle, the most efficient remedy is to ply the thread. The word comes from French, plier, meaning to bend, because if you take a spun thread, bend it in half and let go, the two halves will briefly twist around each other and leave you with a nice thread of twice the thickness that will no longer try to come undone. Try it. The same can be accomplished by twisting 2 separate threads together in the opposite direction from that in which they were spun. This is the normal way to do it. Spinning, incidentally, is a very restful activity. That is a good thing, because it takes an enormous amount of time to make thread by hand. Like knitting, it is pleasantly rhythmic and can be done sitting down, with no physical exertion, just patience. Once enough thread has been made, weaving the cloth can begin. Weaving consists of interlacing 2 sets of threads at right angles to each other. But because thread is very floppy, like spaghetti, unlike the materials that mats and baskets are made of, it is almost impossible to weave the 1 set of threads through the other without one group's being held down tight. That is, putting tension on 1 set of threads. The set that is pulled tight is called the warp, and the frame that holds the warp fast is known as the loom. The 2nd set of threads, which needs to be interlaced into the 1st, is called the weft, an old past tense of the verb weave, that is, what has been woven in. The enterprising reader can take a few short lengths of string, lay half of them out parallel on a table, and try weaving the other half into them at right angles. The problems will become clear immediately. In the simplest weave, called plain weave, each thread of either set goes over 1 and then under 1 thread of the opposite set. You can see cloth of this sort in any household. Simple items like sheets, pillowcases, and handkerchiefs are still made this way. If you have never thought before about the structure of cloth, take a close look at a sheet or handkerchief right now. It is also possible to weave various patterns into the cloth by having the weft go over and under different numbers of warp. To make these structures, to weave, somehow one has to push the weft under some of the warp threads, but over others on the loom. One can do this the tedious way, using a needle to take the weft over or under 1 little thread at a time, row after row. This technique is known as darning, and is still used as a way to mend socks by those who don't just throw holy socks away. Or one can try to lift, at 1 swoop, all the warp threads that have to be gone under, leaving in place all the ones that the weft must go over. This massive lifting forms a little passageway called a shed. In a vertical loom, it looks like the double-pitched roof of a tool shed slanting off to either side. And through this passage, the weaver can insert a whole line of weft at once. How to raise the selected warp threads so nothing gets tangled up. That is not an easy problem. The normal way is to pass each thread through a separate little loop, a heddle in the middle of the loom. And the heddles, in turn, are tied to bars above the warp, the heddle bars. The warp threads can then be controlled by raising the loops in large groups by means of the bars, much the way the sustain pedal on a grand piano raises a whole row of dampers at once, although the dampers, like heddles, can also be raised one at a time. In fact, it seems to have taken several millennia of darning the weft in at a snail's pace before some genius figured out the principle of the heddle. Apparently in the Neolithic, about 6,000 BC, somewhere in northern Iraq or Turkey. From there, the idea must have spread slowly to Europe, to the Orient, and eventually by boat to South America. It is such a difficult concept that it may have been invented only once, but it is what made weaving an efficient process. What, then, is the history of this relationship between women and textiles? When did women begin to take up and develop the fiber crafts? How did women and their special work affect society? And how did the societies affect them? These interactions will form the story of this book. 2. The String Revolution. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 12. Some 40,000 years ago, at the beginning of the last phase of the Old Stone Age, called the Upper Paleolithic, human beings began to act very differently from the way they ever had before. For some 2 million years, they had fashioned simple stone tools, and for 500,000, they had controlled fire and hunted cooperatively in groups. But 40,000 years ago, as the great ice sheets that had covered the northern continents retreated by fits and starts, humans started to invent and make new things at a tremendous rate, like a slow-ascending firecracker that suddenly explodes into 1,000 sparks of varied color, shooting in 1,000 directions. These newly creative hunter-gatherers produced novel tools, such as awls, pins, and various chisel-like burins. But they also began to sculpt animals, people, and other information, possibly calendrical, on pieces of ivory and bone, and to make quantities of beads for adornment. People of the Upper Paleolithic painted pictures of animals and drew around their own hands on cave walls. This is the period of the famous Stone Age paintings from Lascaux, Altamira, and other caves in France and Spain. Just as important, and more to our purpose here, these ancestors invented string and sewing, and thus provided the first chapter in the story of women's long association with the fiber crafts. As near as we can place it, the event occurred 20 to 30,000 years ago, right in the middle of the Upper Paleolithic. While others were painting caves or napping fancy flints, some genius hit upon the principle of twisting handfuls of little weak fibers together into long, strong thread. How do we know this? Nothing so perishable has survived those 25 to 35,000 years. Although by some miracle, one bit of neatly spun and plied cordage has made it through from about 15,000 BC, our earliest evidence is indirect. We infer this humble yet crucial invention from significant changes in other objects of a sturdier nature. The Upper Paleolithic culture known to paleontologists as the Gravettian, from the name of the French site where it was first recognized, La Gravette, on the Dordogne River, seems to have sprung up in Central and Eastern Europe, spreading gradually westward along the south edge of the Great Ice Sheet to southern France and Spain. Radiocarbon dates suggest that the Gravettian culture lasted roughly 6,000 years, from 26,000 to 20,000 BC. During this vast time, needles become common, and beads of shell, tooth, and bone turn up with increasingly small holes. The smaller beads, moreover, begin to occur arranged in neat rows across the bones, sometimes the skulls, of the deceased. Clearly, these beads have been sewn onto garments, made probably of hide. In a cave near the Mediterranean border between modern France and Italy, an adolescent young man was found, carefully interred, wearing a cap or a hairnet, sewn or strung with four tidy rows of tiny shell beads. His body lay protectively around that of a smaller and much older woman, his mother, who wore a bracelet of similar beads. From such artifacts alone, one can deduce a knowledge of sewing. But there is proof that at least some of the thread in use had been twisted together from small natural fibers, rather than cut from long stringy body parts like gut or sinew. It comes from a bone sculpture of a woman wearing a skirt made of string. This small, plump Venus figure, a nickname for all the little bone, stone, and ivory figurines of women from the Paleolithic, comes from L'Espuga in southern France, and is probably of late Gravettian manufacture. Her skirt consists of long strings hanging down the back from a hip band, and the ancient sculptor has troubled to engrave the twists in each string. Furthermore, a detail I did not notice until I began making my own drawing from a large, clear photograph obtained from the Musée de l'Homme in Paris, the sculptor has shown the strings fraying out at the bottom into a mass of untwisted fibers. These cannot be thongs of sinew or hide. They can only be true, twisted fiber thread. We don't know how early to date this great discovery of making string as long and as strong as needed by twisting short filaments together. But whenever it happened, it opened the door to an enormous array of new ways to save labor and improve the odds of survival, much as the harnessing of steam did for the Industrial Revolution. Soft, flexible thread of this sort is a necessary prerequisite to making woven cloth. On a far more basic level, string can be used simply to tie things up, to catch, to hold, to carry. From these notions come snares and fish lines, tethers and leashes, carrying nets, handles and packages, not to mention a way of binding objects together to form more complex tools. Nets, for example, work so efficiently that nowadays they are mostly illegal for catching fish in fresh water. Sportsmen don't consider netting sufficiently sporting, and furthermore, in no time there would be no fish left to spawn more. So powerful, in fact, is simple string in taming the world to human will and ingenuity, that I suspect it to be the unseen weapon that allowed the human race to conquer the earth, that enabled us to move out into every eco-niche on the globe during the Upper Paleolithic. We could call it the String Revolution. What was it like to live in this busy new world, so different from ages past, yet a world still without houses, stoves, and refrigerators, with nothing but rocks and wild plants and animals to supply all one's needs? The stones and bones of archaeology yield but a dry and lifeless picture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.